one, two, three, sack mic.
I go a little bit overboard, but that's why the videos are good.
Well, that's why we will get along, sir, because I
do. You don't go overboard musically ever.
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 That's my whole trip, is minimalism.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, one can wish. Maybe that's why I like bass, because it forces me to do things that are minimal. That's true. Yeah, because when I'm left to my own devices, I make messes musically of various degrees of quality.
Various degrees. I love the eloquence in your wording. It's always very well thought out.
Is it?
Yeah, it is.
I wish, in hindsight, when I was watching the videos, I felt the same way.
Right, I watched them like, this guy's brain must be going crazy. Or he's got a dictionary hidden somewhere.
Yeah, no, I get paid by the syllable.
Okay, well, we already... Welcome, hello... wait.
Here we go.
YouTube, we're already going. I never cut anything.
I agree. Yeah. No circumcision.
YouTube... Hey YouTube pedal nerds, we're actually now talking to someone who uses pedals. Phil X was way cool, but he plugs into an amp and then all these bass players, fuck them. This is actually someone who said he watches pedal videos.
I do.
He is a YouTube pedal nerd. And very, very clearly a big fan of mine, because he's trying to copy me with the hair, with the glasses.
I'm sorry.
This is very clearly... an ode to me.
This was as close to blue as I could get today, but...
You see?
Yeah.
We're Germans, we wear the uniform.
I'm Canadian, I agree with everything you say. I do love pedals. I mean, I think it would be so much more romantic for me to paint a picture of myself after midnight, not rabidly searching product reviews of my iPad in my underpants. Because that would be really depressing. But the reality is that picture that you currently have.
Today, you know what, where we come from, 2 years ago I did a little pedal demo because I bought a cheap-ass China pedal and put it on YouTube. I didn't know what was going on and how crazy that world is out there. And people seemed to like it, and I did another one and another one, and now I seem to be doing nothing else.
What's your channel, is it?
That HP, like Henning Polly, which is my name.
Sure.
And 42, because that's the meaning of life.
Of course, yeah. Yeah, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
See, I mean, you gotta love this guy. I got that in 8 meter high purple letters on my house.
8 meter?
8 meter.
Really?
My whole house is this color and this color and the 42 in this color, 8 meter high letters.
Let me ask you, is that directed at your neighbor? Do they see that? Or is that?
Yes.
Really?
And the old lady who used to live there said, well, I like the blue, but... couldn't you maybe? I'm like, nope. She's in a home now.
Well, maybe Canadians are not the only passive-aggressive ones, then.
She is no more.
Oh.
Well, the thing is, she came every day and asked because she was going.
Dementia.
Yeah. And so, frequently, she asked, ding-dong, what could we do something about the color? I'm like, no.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess it's a benefit.
All the houses are white and yellow. No,
yeah, I understand.
You mentioned Canada. For 4 weeks now, I tried to come up with questions for all these people I was going to interview.
Yeah.
And the only questions, and more and more and more that were piling up were questions of you. So
hit me.
I'm trying to put them in order right there.
First one in your mind.
It's not easy.
First one in your mind.
First one in my mind.
Yeah.
We're at Canada, actually. So, I have worked with an illustrious group of people. By accident, because I kind of slipped accidentally into the progressive world for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. You know, progressive music.
Of course, yeah.
That. And then I had James Lurie sing on an album of mine. And I've worked a lot with Michael Sadler from Saga. And that guy from Kansas.
So you know Thomas?
Thomas?
Bobber from Inside Out.
No! I was never with them.
Oh, okay.
We talked a little bit about the possibility and it never happened. And then another very illustrious countryman of yours, who I'm not legally allowed to say that he's a freaking fuckhead. So the lawsuit said I'm not officially to say that he is, you know...
Piece of shit?
piece of shit. So we're not saying that Sebastian Bach is a piece of shit.
Oh man, I've never met the guy. Really? Oh, okay. No, we're not talking about.
No, that. We're not saying.
No.
And what we can say is that for the album that he sang on, the second Frameshift album, he was his second choice because my first choice was you.
Ah, thank you.
I don't know what happened there, if the label ever wrote you or not. And I think it was going around at the time that you don't do these kind of things.
Well, that was it. I think the first experience that I ever had doing anybody else's music was with Steve. And I think I was always a reluctant singer. And as a result of that experience, where my first foray into it was articulating somebody else's emotional components, I don't ever want to do that again. And so I have been pretty staunch with holding back from that. And if I do vocal stuff, it's usually as a trade-off or something, but I really, and so with management and label as well, I'm just like, save people the hassle. And because my inability to say no is often, I'm just like, please just say no for me so I don't have to get into the dialogue, right?
It's not like you don't have a high output of albums yourself.
I do, but it's the reason for that is separate from perhaps why some other people may have a high output of albums. I did an interview with somebody the other day that described it really well. He said, it seems like you're just smashing through the shit in your life and the shit ends up solidifying as music on the sides as you're trying to make a path through it. And I remember thinking, oh, that's actually a really good way to summarize it for myself at this point. Because I don't like to think of my output as being shit, but it often is because its function is not of a musical nature, more is just a cathartic, like, it rattles around in my head, and the only way I can clear it and get some sleep, because I'm sober, is to write. And so I write a lot, and it clears the space.
I can't really, sometimes I do things on spec, hey, write a prog album. I used to do that, I don't do that anymore. I got sidetracked, and that's good. But I was pretty big in that scene for a while, and then we did this amazing album with Sebastian Bach, and then the shitstorm started in the magazines, and he said, she said, she being
That's happened to me too,
And I wrote an album that just came out, which was all about working through that on message, the crap that I got on message boards for stealing his music, which of course didn't happen. But I wrote an album called Credit Where Credit Is Due, which every song is either making fun of him or dealing with things that happened. And after that, cool. I was totally cool.
Were you a fan of him to begin with? Or?
Huge.
Ah,
huge. And that was my teenage years.
You know, it's funny, a friend of mine said the other day, it's like you can never hate somebody more passionately than somebody who you've had love for.
Yes. And I always said, and I'm breaking this rule here,
okay,
when I'm working together,
it's okay,
just sitting.
Sure, yeah.
I don't want to meet any more of the people that I admire, because I cannot listen to 18 in Life anymore.
No.
And I remember you. These songs meant so much to me.
Totally.
And as much as I love Steve Vai, and it was very important for me as beginning guitar player and all this, I ran into him shoulder on shoulder by accident at the Dream Theater backstage, and that's as much contact as I want to have.
Yeah.
He's probably the nicest guy, but I don't want to know. I just...
Well, you know, I'm sorry to interrupt you. I was going to say, I think a lot of social media gets a bad rap in a lot of cases because in one of the cases, people have the assumption that it tears down the veil of the sort of romantic notion that people who play music that you have an emotional investment in are somehow different fundamentally or superior even in some way. And then when you see them interact as normal people and you realize that they're normal people, sometimes that's like you say, it's contrary to what you want because the music means so much. But I think my view on it is also that I think that's important in a way because I've often thought of at least my own musical output as being separate from me, as being...
yes.
So to be able to get a compliment as being a good worker has often meant more to me than a good songwriter.
If I thought you as a person would be what your music sounds like, or the, you know,
it'd be fucked.
I'd be really scared right now.
Yeah, no.
You know? I mean, depending.
I wouldn't blame you.
If I take Strapping Young Lad, if that music would be represented in a human being,
sure.
No offense, but I'd be kind of scared.
No, I appreciate that, but at the same time, I'm just finishing an autobiography that I had no intention of writing, but I have now, based on requests from this book company, and it forced me to sort of participate in the past in some ways. And I think that when I look back at the music, it's hindsight makes it a real linear progression that when I think back to Strapping, or I think Hummer or Terry or Ziltoid or anything, it's like, well, it's obvious why that led to this, and why was that the way it was? Well, maybe your participation with emotions were underdeveloped, and fear was something that was rooted in anger or sex or death or any of these things, and then the reaction to that becomes these albums. And so there are a highly concentrated version of those emotions, and if somebody was that, that would be horrifying. And again, going back to social media, I like the idea that you can say, no, of course that's not the person, whether or not it's Sebastian Bach or Steve Vai or myself or anybody.
I mean, I've made both experiences. I'm a good friend with Michael Sadler and the whole Saga group, and it's they're the nicest guys. Once he's behind the mic, he's very focused and very shut up, let me do my thing. But and James is really the nicest guy. But on the other hand, the Sebastian Bach experience taught me, just, I don't want to do that. Just leave me alone in my room. I do some stuff. And nowadays, I have 3-4 albums completely written sitting there. Friendship one with James and then Sebastian. I've got 2 more Friendship albums done. I can't get them anywhere. I'm not interested in getting them anywhere. For me, it's the process.
I think there's also, you know, just playing devil's advocate as well. It's probably interesting to get into the psychology of somebody like Sebastian Bach, having not gone through the experiences that he had. And, you know, and that's not because I know nothing of the situation. I'm not saying one thing or another. But at the same time, you know, I've talked to some people here that were in big bands or are still in big bands, and I would have no frame of reference as to how their experiences have shaped their neurosis or all these sorts of things. We played a show recently that was big for me, but in the scheme of like actual music industry is nothing. And then another friend of mine works for U2. He's not in the band or anything, just a peripheral dude. And then I'm thinking to myself, God, I can't even handle what I do without having myself on the verge of some sort of bullshit existential dilemma, let alone be someone like Bono, where you're basically sending troops out to die every time you make a decision on anything. It's like you've got to either be a saint or a psychopath or something in between. And I just don't even think that type of psychology is human, right? So it's hard to have a perspective on it.
It wouldn't be my world. The touring wouldn't be my world. The size of everything wouldn't be my world. I'd be overwhelmed by what I'm looking at. I lived in Boston, lived in LA for a while, and now I live 50 meters, you guys need meters, right?
Of course, yeah, yeah.
From the house where I grew up.
Yeah,
on the
yeah.
other side of the street, I bought a house from where my parents lived, and
does it make you feel comfortable, or?
God, I built a kick-ass studio there. Mm. I'm surrounded by awesome gear, which now I'm getting, hopefully, more and more from you guys. getting stuff for free, and I play with stuff. Everyone who watches my videos says, "Oh my God, this is like the best man cave ever," and you must be happy, and I am. You know, dogs and cats and girlfriend around me, and I get to play with gear.
Yeah, it's awesome.
And I have done a lot of music, and I still produce bands. I love doing that. But if I work on my own music, fine. But I don't have this drive to say, I push my music out there and people listen to it. I've done this for a couple of years. I've had the feedback, hey, you're hot shit, you know what you're doing, but thanks. That's
how
good.
Old are you, if you don't mind me asking?
I had to think about it, 40.
Yeah, yeah.
I just turned 40.
I'm 43, and I think there's a similarity in some of the things that you say I can certainly relate to. I mean, comfort is a big deal for me, and I find that when I was younger, I would put myself in purposely uncomfortable situations just to see how I'd react, and inevitably it was badly. So now I find myself, I live in an environment that I appreciate, and I like it quiet and all this, but these are also things that I didn't recognize when I first started. My connection to myself now has grown in a way that I'm painfully aware of where my motivations for a lot of what I do stems from. And then once you see that, you're like, oh, fuck, man, it's going to be hard for me to continue that, knowing that that's rooted in...
Why you did that.
Yeah. So I think it's... When I think about guitar and what I do and symphonic stuff that I'm working on, and you know, we're doing a couple of guitars with Framus, and the decisions that go into all those aspects of it, it's a lot easier for me to commit to it. And I guess the point of this little spiel is that's why I love bass, because I'm not very good at it. And it is something that forces me to be simple in ways that when I'm left in charge of music, I fail to be. I just always divert to complicated music, and I can't say I enjoy listening to it.
It's difficult. Similar here, everyone says, do prog, and that's easy for me. It's easy for me to go complicated, but it's not necessarily what I'm into or what I listen to.
Yeah, no.
And I saw a lot of similarities between us when I saw that video where you talked about the gear that you used for Casual Little Cool.
Right, yeah, yeah.
And you're like, I found this old telly and I just got in, am I allowed? You're playing Fender, right? So I'm allowed to say telly.
Oh, sure, yeah. Yeah, so
if it's not a Fender, I'm not allowed to say telly.
Oh, really?
Just give me a phone Fender.
Really? Well, that's that's actually kind of gratifying. You got an email from Fender?
Yeah, because I wrote in a video, it's a telly.
You can say telly style, though.
It was a different brand in that.
Yeah, I have a Fender telly, but one of the guitars that we're working on today is a replacement for that. That's you know, the same sort of construction, but with a modified couple of things. So I could...
Oh, Marcus hasn't told me about that. I've seen the top of the moth.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I've seen that.
It's cool.
Way cool.
Well, it's got Jazzmaster kind of contour on the contours, but it's more of a Strat style, but it's thick like a Les Paul, and it has training wheels on it, and the whole works, right? But I think the thing is, my relationship with this company is such that I finally feel comfortable committing to them. And I mean, it's like, I really do like, I've been married for so many years, and I find that there's a real value to me creatively to committing to things. So with Framus, I'm like, let's commit that this is the guitar that I use, but I also have a lot of use for a telly. So can we make something that fills that aspect of what I do? And that's the other guitar that we're working on.
I just discovered that style of guitar 2 or 3 years ago when I bought this one, also extremely butterscotch yellow, just like the one you had. And then you talked about, like, you know, the more simple, just a very simple setup with some effects. And then I immediately went and bought the album on iTunes. But the Super Mega Deluxe, way too many tracks on it version.
Casualties?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
And I started listening to it and I was like, okay, here's someone who doesn't mind experimenting, which more we know, but who doesn't mind to go in a different way that doesn't necessarily please the fans of the music that it usually has.
Somebody asked me in an interview earlier, what's the biggest advice you could give to young musicians? And I think it would be a good time to reiterate that by just saying, learn to fail efficiently. Like, I mean, I've never had a huge level of success in anything that I've done. And I've made a ton of humiliating public experiments, if you want to look at it that way. But
that's
the benefit,
that's
it. And that's why doing something like Casualties is something that I felt I could go into without any fear, because ultimately my reasons for doing music, like I said earlier, are to articulate this path or whatever. But also I want to make something that I want to hear. And Casualties was a real freeing and honest expression of where I was at that point.
It was very pleasing. I listened to it one time through. I had zero time, but I listened to it and you could hear Devin Townsend in all of it.
Sure.
I mean, very different style, but
it's the same shit. It's the same as Strapping. It's the same as Ziltoid.
It's the same the same approach to arranging.
Sorry.
And that is one of the billion questions. Let's go there.
Cool.
I'm an arranger. That's what I'm trained to do. That's what I try to do. I always wanted to be the guy in the background helping people, and I got pushed into, you know, do pedal demos, whatever. But I'm interested in the pieces of the puzzle. And we always see you talk about, you know, a guitar. We see you playing, which was brilliant, by the way, EMG TV. I watched the video of Kingdom, and oh my.
Thanks, man.
Freaking God.
Thanks.
But not my God, someone's God, sorry.
Oh, your freaking God.
Yeah, that's not mine.
Oh, his?
His, yeah, not his, it's someone's, someone probably, whatever. Let's not get into that.
No
anyway,
one wants that God.
I just lost a whole bunch of viewers.
Okay, so EMG TV.
Kingdom, awesome. Yeah. Watch this. It was brilliant because you were... Not super serious. You played such an amazingly powerful song with the vocal performance that was out of this world.
Thanks, man.
I can say that. And but you show guitars. We talk about pedals, and it's, you know, the TC Electronic videos. Please, guys, watch this. They're the funniest shit out there.
Tor is fucking awesome.
Yeah. And the pedals are fucking awesome.
Yeah, they are.
I just got into them. Started doing demos.
Yeah, they're great.
I've written Stefan Fast. From TC, about 7 times, sent me the, is it viscous? No, it's not, is it?
Yeah, it is.
It's supposed to be viscous.
Viscous, yeah. Okay. Yeah, I thought it was vicious, but it's viscous.
I said, send me the vibe. I love vibes, and I'm still don't have it.
That's, I think vibes and choruses are the two effects that I would use least. Oh, no, flanger. I have zero application for a flanger, followed closely by a chorus. But I mean, it's funny, I recently, because I have an interest in pedals, I've been working with so many, and experimenting with so many new pedal companies that, you know, I'd love to ask or get a dialogue about some pedals, because I've got a lot of opinions on a lot of them all of a sudden. So, what are you using recently? What's your biggest find?
Yeah. Felix asked me yesterday, I just said, hi Felix, I do pedal demos. He's like, what's your favorite overdrive? Go! I'm like, and
for which application? Okay, what's your favorite overdrive for a clean boost?
I don't do that.
I would do a Maxon OD808 for a clean boost in front of a heavy amp. And for low gain breakup, I think the Greer light speed is the greatest. I also like the Archer. That's a good one, but in conjunction with the light speed, it's a great.
I don't have the Archer, but it's a clone type pedal, right?
It is, yeah.
I just got the Merman from VFE pedals.
I've got a couple from VFE, yeah.
And I did the Triumvirate. Can I freaking say that?
Is that from VFE?
It's a multi band distortion. I had that.
I tested
that, and Peter was impressed by the demo, and said, send me more stuff. And he said, what do you want? I said, I want the Focus, because it's such a...
I got the Focus. That's really interesting.
So here's the thing.
Yeah.
If you want a creamy, more for pop stuff, a really creamy, nice crunch sound for chords, I used the Merman, which doesn't have a lot of gain by itself.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Focus behind it, I was sitting there, was blown away. Absolutely beautiful.
I got to try that. The Focus, I thought was brilliant, but the application that I use a clean boost for... has never required that many options, so I was lost on it in the time that I've used it. However, I took it to the rehearsal space the day before I left to Germany, and my intention is to put it through its paces. I also got the ice cream from them and their chorus. That was, I really liked the chorus. I thought that was.
Even if you have no use for it.
I don't, but I think if I did, I got that one and the Providence one, and those are the two that I really like.
Since I got the Strymon stuff.
Which is killer.
I have started using effects that I've never used. I'm pushy sometimes, and you have to be when you get shit. So I wrote to the European distributor and I said, hey, you guys need German manuals. And there's really only one guy who knows.
With the Strymon stuff?
Yeah.
I've got the Blue Sky and I've got the El Capistan.
Yeah. And I wrote to them and said, I'm going to translate the manuals, but I want everything I translate. I want the product.
Cool.
And so I got almost everything. And when you have the Mobius, you find that there's modulation sounds that you would have never used, but rotary. Would you use a rotary?
Well, no, not for an analog delay sound. No. But I think this is the thing is I find that my my parameters for what I'm using these things for are very specific. Therefore, I'm working with Daniel Gigrig in the UK. Yes. And we're putting together an absurd pedal board, but, you know, there's like the...
You haven't seen the pedal boards I put together. No. There's nothing... Well, the ones I do haven't worked yet. They're just big. But Daniel does incredible stuff.
He really does. Yes. He's a nice guy, too.
And he... I watched him put together a couple boards. He knows his shit.
Yeah, and he's funny. He's got a good sense of humor. But I guess... but even at that, it's like each aspect of it. So, for example, if I was going to use... an analog delay, I would have no use for a rotary.
Mm-hmm.
I would try and find a rotary that was specifically a rotary,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah.
And there are so many cool delays. I got a bunch of stuff from Source right before I left that mm-hmm. I haven't tried yet. And the Nunabur as well, which is a really cool pedal, right? But I think if I'm going to use an analog delay, it's like, man, there's such a glut of them. And it's become this
It's really difficult to... Okay, it sounds like an analog delay. Well, that one also sounds like an analog delay. And you know, that one... It's also a pretty good analog delay.
Well, I think that's why it becomes important for you to be able to articulate exactly what your needs are. Because if you don't, I think you get lost in the options so quickly. We're fortunate that the pedal market has opened up in such a way that anything you need in some form, if it's not available now, will be soon. And I think when you get to the TC stuff or the Nunabur stuff or the Source stuff where you can program and really save those things, it really comes down to less about getting a whole bunch of pedals and trying it until you figure out what you like. More so, I think it comes down to, I want an analog delay that has a rotary sound.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, I think you can find it, right? Until that time, you're just gonna be lost in a cloud of pedals,
you
right?
You said you got the Blue Sky.
Yeah.
But have you played the Big Sky?
No.
Which is
I have, but only momentarily.
Okay, which is something I wanna get to because the Big Sky has reverbs that are, you know, we all know the hall, the spring and all this, but the Big Sky's got incredibly creative reverbs, like the bloom that comes up after you play, or the choral where it's being the reverb being sent through a formant filter that sounds like a choir, which I could imagine would be your sound.
But the one time I tried the Big Sky, Che, who sings in Casualties of Cool, she bought herself the Big Sky, and that's the only time I tried it. She had it set up with the shimmer. That was really cool.
Insane.
Yeah.
I mean, you would think these things are overdone. But when we're talking about overdoing things, we're talking about Devin Townsend. Sorry.
That's all right.
But where I wanted to go is, like, we always talk about guitars, you talk about pedals and all this, but when I listen to anything you've done, especially the big stuff you mentioned, orchestral, this is a tiny element of it.
Mm-hmm.
And me as an arranger, I see the guitar is together with the bass drum and the bass, that's the foundation.
Mm-hmm.
But there isn't tons of, I'm going to say, detailed riffing or guitar.
Of course.
Detail. There's, yeah. This is, for you, this is the foundation.
Yeah.
And then there's the synth pad,
mm-hmm.
which is always gigantic, mm-hmm. always huge. And then there's the reverb.
Mm-hmm.
On, I'm going to say Z2,
mm-hmm.
but it's only the Americans say Z2, right?
I think so, yeah.
So it is Z.
I'll take Z or Z.
Come on, make up your mind.
I'll take Z because I'm Canadian.
See, Leslie, I told you.
But
I have a friend, she's half American.
Yeah.
In her lower half. And she says, Z? What the fuck is that? That's not a thing. I said, no, this is how you say it correctly.
You know, there's so much, it's like you hear about the animosity between, not even animosity, but the little brother, big brother thing between Canada and America. And I was born in Vancouver and lived there, but man, the majority of my closest friends are American, and it's if you're going to take two cultures that are less dissimilar, those would be it. I mean, North America, you go into a Canadian Kentucky Fried Chicken, and the awe is that we don't have corn. And, you know, this is like the depth of the similarity, you know,
yes.
the differences. It's such a close culture. And I think that being said, I'll go with Zed, but that makes saying ZZ Top slightly less...
But it's not YYZ, it's YYZ.
Is it?
I'm
terrible with all that shit.
Rush is YYZ. Getty says YYZ.
I'm terrible with all that shit. It's like I when it's cold, I say it's zero. When it's hot, I say it's 90. You know, I guess I'm I'm somewhere in the middle. I'll take it. But when I think about the foundation of it all, and like musically what the guitar is to represent and all this, it's, I don't like options. This is even going back to what we were talking about with pedals. It's like I've got very specific needs because it's coming from a vision, a musical vision that is really complete before I start. In fact, I don't begin to demo or record typically until the ideas are fully fleshed out. Therefore, the guitar acts like somebody who would write on a piano for me. And if I write something with whatever technical facility I have on the guitar that's fast or complicated, often I only do that in the demo stages and then have something else present that.
For someone who can't play like you can, which we all know he can, and if you don't know that, why the fuck are you doing that? Why are you watching Devin Townsend if you don't know how well that can play? I mean, are you crazy? Then I always wonder, like, okay, why is he taking like a belly synthy part for that? And not saying that synthesizers are bad.
No, sure.
I went to Berkeley and studied sound design, arranging and sound design. So I studied how to twist knobs on synthesizers, and now I find myself trying to forcibly do as much as I can with guitar sounds and delays and pads and try to do synthy kind of stuff in arrangements with guitars to avoid using synthesizers because I see it as a challenge. But for you, it's like even though you could do all this stuff with guitar, you jump to different.
I want to write symphonies. That's what I want to do. I don't want to be in a rock band.
Thank you for saying, because yeah, we were on the way here, we listened to Z2. Mm-hmm. And we said immediately, if anyone would ever be perfect for doing the metal needs, oh my god, I said the M word. We're gonna get to that in a bit. I should have done it at the beginning.
You're good. No, September I do a symphony. I'm doing it in Belgium, 100-person symphony, 100-person choir. But that's the reason why I've always done it. I mean, the way that I have. And the symphony is gonna be done in surround too. I mean, a lot of times when people think about my music, it is very excessive because that's how I write. And when I think about, when you ask or suggest why would I do a bell sound there, it's because I'm following what it sounds like to me. And so often I'm struggling in the dark to try and articulate a sound that's very clear to me, and the guitar is maybe just a place to start. However, in the past, over the 30 fucking records that I've done, a lot of it ends up being this compressed wall of sound that's in a stereo field.
Wall of sound, I've said a billion times when I'm trying to explain your music.
And that's never been the intention, unfortunately. It's been the outcome. So my thought now is if I do it with a symphony and I do it in surround, perhaps what I'm trying to achieve will be less fatiguing, not only to the listener, but also to myself. I remember doing Infinity without any formal engineering training on ADAT, and the end result of it is this tiny, compressed, like, blob of static when the intention for it was to be immersive. But again, it's like you talk about failing, as I mentioned earlier. I think that's a huge motivator to have fucked it up so many times that now I'm like, okay, well, don't do that again. Don't do that again. Now we should do it with the symphony, and we'll do it in surround.
This is so absolutely incredible to listen to because you have this incredibly unique musical voice that no one in the style that I'm going to get to here, in that style sounds, you know what I'm saying.
That's okay.
No one in that style, I would call you the master of modern metal. Sorry, because it is very, very unique. It is this wall of sound while still being, in no matter how aggressive you can get, it is still melodic, there's still this element, this harmony in there. And buried under so much reverb, so much synthesizer, and still being accessible. And but as you said, it can be tiring.
Of course.
I mean, I can clearly say it is a double CD, you know, listening to it, it is difficult.
Of course,
but the thing is, from you hearing that, this is just what comes out. And you're trying to go for something different.
Of course, yeah, totally. And I mean, the only reason I have so many records is I haven't gotten it right. I mean, it's like I'm not consistently putting out records thinking, nailed it, nailed it, nailed it. I'm like, well, that's as close as my patience is going to allow me and my finances to get at this point on this particular theme at this particular time. And I mean, I think when you talk about any masters of anything, my point of view on anything musically is all of us, me, you, anybody, is we're just sort of contributing to a pool of other humans trying to articulate things that we can never reach. So again, it was a good interview that I did the other day, and when he had mentioned a true definition of irony being something along the line of, I'm just paraphrasing, recognizing the spiritual significance of it all and trying to achieve it, but never ever being remotely capable of achieving it. And there's a humor to that that I love, and I think that my reasons for making music are not because I'm trying to impress anybody. There's a part of me that, you know, I need to make a living and all these sorts of things, which helps with gear and all this. But I mean, but ultimately, I'm trying to make a contribution to a ton of other humans that are trying to do a real similar thing. This is just my middle class white Canadian version of it, right?
It's no matter what you do, it's going to give someone something. Yeah. I have albums that I'm not very proud of. I get emails from people saying,
oh, I got 30 of them.
I wouldn't say that.
I'm also proud of them, if that helps, you know.
But I get emails from people saying, this really gave me something, we played the song at the wedding, and I'm thinking, I was never happy with this, but I would never tell anyone, and I hate it when artists do that, oh, I really don't like the shit that I did there, because it gave someone something.
Oh, I can agree with that. I appreciate that. I think in a sense, along that line, if somebody comes up and who has an emotional investment in something you've done, if your knee-jerk reaction is to tell them that, no, it's shit, basically what you're saying to them is that your opinion means nothing.
Yes.
Right. I appreciate
that. I had that, I heard some behind-the-scenes stuff with Dream Theater where band members said, oh, I really hate that album, we'll never play any of that. It was my favorite album.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that.
It's difficult to listen to it now.
Well, I think there's also, again, devil's advocate, the connection that the people who create these things, as you well know, have, are rooted in the emotional upheaval sometimes that has caused those things to appear. So maybe the reason why Dream Theater hate that record is based more on their emotional connection to that time rather than the songs, right?
But I still wouldn't say it. I wouldn't take that away from the fans.
I have said it in the past, and I think that in some scenarios it has taken it away from people, and that wasn't my intention. But at the same time, again, going back to failing, it's good to experience those things, to know, oh, okay, well, I know now that cause and effect, if I do that, the result is that, and do you want that result? No, then don't do that again. You know?
Now, talking about where you want to, you always end up at a similar place musically. I like to be challenged. So as soon as magazines said, oh, this guy's really hot in Prague and he should do more and more stuff and blah blah, I wasn't interested anymore because, okay, check mark, apparently I can do Prague. And then I like to set a set of parameters for myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I did an album, because I listened to some Dio.
Sure.
And realized how absolutely ridiculous the lyrics are.
Good singer, holy shit.
Yeah. No, it's Woody Diver.
No, right. A good singer, though,
yeah,
Woody Diver.
Woody Diver, yeah. And that was a joke from a German with a Canadian.
Zed was? We're back to that?
Yes.
Alright.
You only get that if you saw before. If you skip here, you've no idea what we're talking about.
Yeah.
So watch the whole fucking thing. And I listened to this, I'm like, yeah, it's good music, but it's a total joke, lyrically. And I said, okay, I want to do this. I want to do an album like that. And I went ahead and then we did a like list of 150 metal words. You know, Strong, Blood, Serpent, Babylon. And
that'd be a good name for a record right there.
The record is called...
Strong, Blood, Serpent, Babylon.
The record's called Midnight Sky Masquerade.
That's good.
It means nothing.
Yeah, but it's epic. Yeah, you can only imagine
the band's
festivities
called,
at that
particular... The band's called Shadows Minion.
Shadows Minion.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it is all a tribute to all the different styles of the 80s metal, mm-hmm. as I've heard you do one song at least.
Oh, of course. Yeah, yeah.
That was which dressed as a devil in glasses. It was brilliant. But the music was still brilliant.
That song was a good riff. But you know what's funny? It's like... I was still drinking back then. That was like 12 years ago. If you look at that video, my tongue's purple because to get into that costume, I drank a bottle of red wine and danced around like an idiot. And I think I vomited directly after. So
awesome.
Yeah, so the purple tongue is always the
But what was going?
Sneakers.
We can't see those. What was going is I like to put up a set of parameters. So saying 80s sound. So guitar, everything needs to sound like 80s. And after that, the second channel was menu was all 70s. So I said, it all needs to be this one amp on clean, cranked up. So that way I don't go to the other 15 amps. I take options away from me.
Yeah.
And that way it forces me to work a certain way. Now,
do the same.
What would happen if I took the options away from you to say, you're only allowed a maximum of 5% mix on the reverb?
I think that's a good idea. In fact, I did an EP for this autobiography I'm finishing now. We did it in Iceland with a friend of mine, and there's only reverb on a bit, and it kills me to hear it. However, the symphony, I've got a producer who's from a totally different school, and he doesn't want me to use the same safeties that I've been utilizing for many years. I think it's a good thing to be out of your comfort zone, but I'm also not the type of personality that readily wants to put myself in that scenario. I think I'm astute enough to find people that will force it on me in a certain way. Maybe not force it on me, but suggest it to me with a reason as to why it would work.
You have to find other ways of accomplishing what you want to accomplish.
Of course, yeah.
So, I mean, Casualties was already a deviation, Devin deviation, double E, from where you're going, but you still have the option of some electronics and those lush soundscapes.
That was a last minute thing too, because I think my fear took over in the end of the record, where I was like, you know what?
It was too direct?
It was too direct, and I think I don't regret it because it's not the last record that I'm going to do with that style, but the same guy who's producing the symphony is going to do that next one as well. And I like the idea of the next one being more more live, a little dirtier. And I think the thing with reverb for me as well is it becomes a safety blanket in a lot of ways, and had become primarily because it was unique at the time. The effects that I was using were a lot harder to achieve. You know, it's now you can get... I'm doing a pedal with more for, it's like a cheap little three button pedal that's got
more?
Yeah.
Chinese company?
Yeah, yeah. And it's gonna be, it's two delays and a reverb that are all in one, that you can inter-swap it, and it's got a little screen, and it's like $120. It basically is my whole reverb thing and delays, because I got a specific way
to do it. Once these cameras are off, we got shit to talk about.
Yeah.
I know them. I went to China.
Yeah.
We'll talk after this.
Yeah. But basically, the idea is to be able to do it all in one place. And my whole view on reverb in general now is it's become easy. There's not a lot of reason for me to stick to it, because it's at the time it was kind of a unique thing.
Yeah.
But now, you know, I got two pedals from Source Audio the other day that I can do that sound with, right? It's not...
If anyone can do it, then...
Yeah.
It's also, for me, I mean, I love you as a vocalist. You are so unique in a way that you can have the cleanest tone and completely controlled, go to a raging thing and then come back. I know very few vocalists that can do this. I was lucky enough to find someone two villages over.
Yeah, it is lucky.
He's completely untrained, but he can do this just because he can.
Sure.
And so thank you, I don't need anymore.
That's good.
No. But I feel that on a lot of your recordings, the voice becomes part of the symphony. You take it quite far back in the mix.
I hate singing.
In this.
That's why I want to play bass. I mean, I think the thing is,
it comes back to the bass.
It does, because it's the only thing that I can play that I think sounds good when it's minimal. Everything else I do diverts so quickly to reverbs and complications and layers. And
is it that you, because where the voice sits in your mix, is it that you hate singing or that you hate the way your voice sounds?
It's because I'm insecure, and it puts me in a position where by doing the things that I think are important for me, lyrically and vocally, it makes me vulnerable, I think, in ways that I've never been comfortable with. And I when I was young, I didn't want to sing. I auditioned tons of singers, but singers are just so full of shit that in order...
Really? I wouldn't know.
Yeah. Well, I became a singer. I'm full of shit. It took me a couple of years of thinking that I was above that for me to recognize that the reason why singers are typically so insecure is because the physical act of singing is... it's so conditional on your frame of mind, on your body, on your on your health, and all these things that when I hear my voice, I think, regardless of the quality of it, you know, it's always debatable. It's like you say, it's perspective. It's still fucking me, you know. And it's I do like myself. I don't hate myself, you know. But at the same time, I have no illusions that about the fact that as I've gotten older, my need to be seen is nowhere near what it once was. And I like to support, I like to help, I like to be a part of a team. And
so if you had a vocalist,
yeah, which would be a female,
which would be completely weird for me, but if you had a vocalist, would in the mix, would that vocalist sit more up front?
Of course. Of course, and that's why I like the idea of working with women, because it's I don't need a male vocalist. I can do that.
Talking about women, of course, very different than the vocalist you had. I don't remember any.
Shay.
Yeah. One of my favorite vocalists of all time is Seth Jordan. And again.
Oh, Seth Jordan. Okay.
And again, Canadian. I had the mega pleasure to have her on two of my songs, where I gave her a rough vocal. And I can hit the notes, but you don't want to hear them there. They sound bad. And she took exactly that and just made it beautiful. So
awesome.
If you ever see the success, thank you. So that was one of the highlights of my career, to have Seth Jordan sing two of my songs.
Awesome.
Screw the other guys. And yet again, Canadian. What's it with the Canucks being good at shit?
Well, not all of us. Not me in most things, other than the few things I do in music.
Well, we disagree on that, but I guess that's okay.
Well, no. I mean, I think it's... God. What else is Canadian? Well, no.
Mike Myers, funny guy.
Yeah.
It must be a very artistic country.
I don't know. I think it's, like I said earlier, it's very similar to Canada. It's a different political system, but slightly. I think Canadians are a close, like, personality equivalent, although it is significantly different, is Swedish. I find there's a lot of similarities between Swedish and Canadian.
I can see that.
Yeah. But at the same time, it is, we're, I think, 35 million people with a landmass that's larger than the U.S., and the U.S. is 400 million, so...
Maybe they're just pissed off at each other because they're too close, and
I totally
you guys have a space, you're like, hey, if
totally
you want me,
that.
Stay over there.
But we have Walmart and all that, too. I mean, I think that if you put that amount of population in Canada, I think that the identity of Canada would be indistinguishable from the States in a lot of ways, because you can't maintain a lot of the things that I think Canada holds on to as culturally identifiable, like healthcare and certain aspects of our political system, with that sheer amount of numbers when it comes to people.
Yes.
Right?
I mean, the U.S. is often being criticized, but it's...
It's just people.
It's a whole bunch of countries within a country that need to be governed, and it's... I think it's possibly too big to be... effective.
It's hard for me to say. I do so much work in the States, and my American friends, I mean, I'll do anything for them. It's like, but then again, it's the same with my friends from other countries too. I think it's really easy to identify people with their culture. And when I was a kid, I tattooed Canada on my leg because I was looking for an identity. I was so lost that I thought, well, I must be a Canadian. That's how I identify myself. But I mean, ultimately, it's like we're just a bunch of kids trying to get along,
if
right?
If people thought all Germans were like me, then that would be very strange.
You know, it's funny too, but there's aspects of Germany that I just absolutely love. You know, my family and I have been on vacation here for the past 8 days. And I think there's a directness that comes from, not everybody, but you know, the typical sort of... identity that people might, even as a German, you might agree with. It's there's not a lot of gray And I think that that's same what I find with my friends in Holland as well. And personally, I really like that because I have a hard time. I have a hard time with emotional intelligence. I rarely know what I'm feeling. So when people say, this is what I feel, I'm like, oh, whether or not I agree with it, at least there's no questions, you know?
Yeah. Well, you can read a little bit more in the US, and I kind of like that, but everyone's just extremely nice. And you don't necessarily...
Not everyone.
Well, but at least...
I think America gets a bad rap.
Let's say paid staff. I mean, any server in any restaurant, they're just overly nice because that's their job. Well, try to go in the restaurant here and get service with a smile. It might be difficult, you know? If they're pissed off, they're pissed off.
But they're not lying to you.
No.
And I think that anybody can see if somebody in a service industry, regardless of whether or not it's America or German, are legitimately being nice to you or if they're just full of shit. And if they're full of shit, I mean... I find myself as resentful of a fake smile as I am of someone who's just overtly being rude to me. You know, it's like, it's a similar thing. I produced a bunch of American bands, and having spent time working in America, it's really was eye-opening for me as well to see where the genesis of a lot of these kind of maybe things that are viewed as a stereotype mm-hmm. are actually from. And I think like anything, when you talk about perspective, it's a lot easier to make an assumption on something once you see where it stemmed from. And that assumption at that point becomes like informed.
Realization.
That's it.
Assumptions are just...
I think everything's an assumption though, but if it's an informed, I don't even know if that makes sense, an informed assumption. Yeah.
No, that doesn't make sense. Huh?
Well, an informed decision in your own mind as to why this person is acting a certain way, you know? And again, it's...
Having background on anything is a good idea.
I agree. And I think America as well, it's Canada is just 250 million people away from being the same country in a lot of ways.
You really think?
I'm not sure, but I think it's my informed assumption.
It's my informed assumption. Well, for Travis and especially Hans Peter, who invited us, and I mean, cannot thank the team enough.
No,
I definitely want to talk the tiniest bit about the guitars.
Sure.
And now I got to do something because I'm going to say the M word again, and I highly apologize.
Metal, I don't care, go.
No, but the thing is, see, every time I say that word, and I do a metal pedal or guitar on my channel. For some reason, I did this on one video because it just came out.
Sure.
And now I've got to do this every single time. And it's embarrassing as hell in front of one of my vocal idols. But
sure, no, thank you.
It might be loud.
Cool.
So, Devin Townsend, the kind of music he does, la 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 la, the guitars, what you do with them, it's... You know, that kind of music.
That's very good. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Phil X was like, holy crap, I can get that high. And then he's like, how high can you get? I said, well, I see sharp. He's like, no way. Like, you go to play C sharp and I hit that. I got 3.5 octaves, all crap.
I was preparing myself to not flinch during that, but it that was pretty pretty impressive, man. Well, you know, I think the
funny thing.
Yeah. Oh, if I did that,
I can die now. Thank you.
I'd be done for the day if I did that right now, man. You know, I think the thing about metal too, and I think it's funny. I did an interview for CBC in Canada, which is a Canadian version of BBC, and no commercials and all this sort of stuff. And the classical. It was some classical thing, and a lot of times. Classical music sort of takes that sort of cork-sniffing thing to an extent that just makes me crazy. And so this classical program director wanted to get me on CBC to discuss heavy metal, but he was convinced before I got on there that I was, you know, snorting ants and Motley Crue t-shirts and the whole works. And I kind of have spent a great deal of energy saying, I don't mind being involved with metal because it's a type of musical dynamic that is, you can't achieve in other ways. And when I think about classical music that I like, Stravinsky and all these sorts of typical avant-garde sorts of things, when they get heavy, I think, well, that could benefit if they had the ability to take it to those sonic degrees that heavy metal offers.
Bach would have had drop D, excuse me, of course.
Not for all of them.
I'm sorry. Oh my God, not Bach. Bach's all really, really...
Wagner.
Beethoven.
Oh, Beethoven.
Beethoven and Bach. Wagner. That would have been an 8-string.
Of course. Holy so God. I think that's the thing. It's like, I think that metal has given itself a bad rap in a lot of ways, just because the passion for the genre has been such that people are, specifically from an older generation, become exclusionary towards anybody who's interested, and it becomes sort of a parody of itself. But I mean, that doesn't mean that I should, like, distance myself from it. It's a huge part of my dynamic. And so when this guy was doing the interview, I wanted to say that. I want to say, look, I'm not embarrassed by it. I mean, I need it. It's when it gets heavy, I want it to be heavy.
And it's fun.
But he was just agitated. You could just tell. He was just like, no, you're an idiot. No, you're an idiot. It's heavy metal. And I'm just thinking, he's like, no, tell me some stories about hookers and blowing. I'm like, I've never done cocaine, and I'm married, and I got kids. And he's like, no. And then by the end of it, I hung up the phone. I was like, fuck that guy. You know, like, fuck that guy. And then, but this is the kicker of the story, is then someone sent me a thing on YouTube of a Subway sandwich commercial with a heavy metal band riding a cookie, wearing leather jackets, doing what you had just done. And I remember thinking to myself, like, oh, maybe we are like we're just imbeciles. Yeah. Maybe that's what it is.
I mean,
so I'm unsure.
For me, I've listened to a lot of metal. I've done it. I've done prog metal. I love playing the heavy shit. It's fun, but I don't take it too seriously. What I can't stand are these aging guys in leather that try to hold on to something to 20 years ago and think that the new album they do, which is about wizards and trolls and whatever, is the newest, hottest shit that we've never seen.
Yeah, but I think a lot of those guys have a financial need to do that, to say that, because if you become an enterprise based on doing something you did when you were 20, that included all those things that you just mentioned, then you have kids and you buy a house and you've got a lease on a car.
But
what are you going to say about
it? I don't buy it.
Lots of people do, though.
I mean, I don't buy it from them. I don't buy that it's honest, that they're still into that. And if they just go in and go through the motions, Frank Zappa asked, does humor belong in music?
I agree.
And if they, I clearly, you know, can see that, but if they take it so seriously, like on the Shadows Minion album, it was pretty silly. And the reviews were threefold. It was either they got that the lyrics were supposed to be funny and making fun of it, but they got it and they loved it. They said, hey, this is an homage with a little bit of a, you know, making Spinal Tap fun of it. Then there were people who didn't get that at all and just thought it was a serious album and loved it like a serious metal album, an 80s metal album. And then there were the people that saw that they might have really enjoyed the music, they really would have, but they saw that I wasn't fully into it and making fun of it a little bit, and because of that, didn't like it. Mm. Now, that's a stupid reason not to like something.
I don't know about that,
no.
If I may offer.
Okay.
I think for myself, the one thing that I've had to really be conscious of is the fact that, well, for one, you know, there's always people smarter than us and not as smart as us, and those people are also our audiences, and I think that the one thing that has allowed me to do things like Casualties or Ziltoid or The Hummer or Strapping or Ghost is the fact that when I'm going in that direction, it's because that's a part of me that really feels the need to do that. Now, I'm not saying that that's not the case with you at all, but at the same time, I think that if I did something that wasn't overtly a parody, where I'm saying this is a parody, then I think that the people who have an emotional investment in the past work might be like, okay, are you trying to trick us with this? You know?
I understand. I think the people that listened to that particular album had, because it was so different from the prog stuff I did.
Sure.
I don't think there was in any way my audience. But I don't want to insult them if they didn't like it, they didn't like it. And there's a million reasons not to like something.
May I just, what was your intention with it?
To have fun doing it.
Okay.
I'm frankly not very interested in getting this stuff out there. I like the process. I love the putting the pieces of the puzzle together. Mm-hmm. Even when it comes to mixing, I hate that bit.
I understand.
I like the putting the pieces together and...
So the content is almost of, not of no significance, but...
It, sometimes it is.
I agree
Second
with that.
Frameshift album, very, very difficult about different kinds of violins and very difficult lyrics. And sometimes I just don't want to deal with difficult lyrics and very serious stuff. And then I write this kind of album. Mm-hmm. And then I did a classic rock album. And that was all about Yo Yo Mama, I Wanna Come and Do Me.
Do you consider yourself a musician?
That's a very, very good... it's what I tell people. And they ask, what do you do? I say, I'm a professional musician. But I look at anyone else, my God, he's making me...
No, this
is a very, very good question. No.
Yeah, nor do I.
I look at the guitar player and I go, oh, that's way cool, I wish I could do this. And I know I can do it. I have guitars and I have amps. And I can do this or better. But I look at him saying, this is way cool. And,
oh, yeah.
And I don't consider myself part of this.
That's why I want to play bass.
And it comes back to that.
It's true. Because when I go to a jam, I went to a blues jam where I had to just play dum-dum-dum-dum-dum-dum. And the guitar player knew all the licks, man. And he played it like a guitar player. I mean, I've got a ton, not a ton, but I've got a fair amount of facility on the guitar. But it's not because it's coming from a place of a connection to the instrument rather than I need something to get my ideas voiced. Mm-hmm. So when I see a guitar player, it's like a guitar player, man. Like there, when I was a kid, my neighbor played Van Halen licks, but he played them right. I could play Eruption, but I didn't play Eruption. I did the parts, and but he did it. It's like, you know, he touched it. Like Jeff Beck, for example, is a brilliant guitar player, and when I see him play, I think to myself, he's communicating with that as his voice. Mm-hmm. And I think, in a sense, that's almost like the definition of a true musician. Is if your communicative qualities are through your instrument, whether or not that's even studio.
You know, I know exactly what you mean. If I would consider my voice to be the whole, to be able to put things together, but sometimes I look down on guitar and say, oh wait, I am playing guitar, I'm a guitar player. But that's only like a fraction of a second that I realized that this is actually what I do. But I know exactly what you
mean. Well, it's a very broad term. Like, am I a musician? Of course I'm a musician. Are you a musician?
We're making music, but it's different.
Yeah, okay.
I know exactly what you mean.
Yep.
That was very, very insightful. I mean,
unintentional.
But, you know, everyone, the guys that watch my videos, you too. They say, oh, you're a very good player, and of course it's nice for the ego, and it's, I know it's partially only to I noodle around a bit, but it's always nice, but I always think, I'm not on guitar where I would want to be, and I'll never be, because I do other things now, and now more 90% of my time is spent doing YouTube videos, which is great. I mean, I love doing this, and this has allowed me, I mean, my other job, when I did the albums, has allowed me to hang out with James Green, do an album. Now I can talk to Devin Townsend, which without the demos would have never happened. I want to talk to you about this guitar.
Sure.
Because I looked at this and it's weird. Mm. I'm going to pick this up.
Go for it.
And because I just, you should pick it up, but yeah, I'm not going to let you because I had so much fun playing this.
Perfect. Sorry. Yep.
First of all, I said to Marcus, who was the product manager here, white flame.
Yeah.
No one does that.
I love it.
And he explained to me why. It's very, very difficult to do the stain, and only their paint, the UV paint that they use, is capable of not melting away based on what they do.
You have to turn the lights on though before we continue.
Yeah, that's okay. What do you mean? What lights?
These lights. Alright.
Oh man. No, I want it even more. but what this thing does, first of all, it's not a kind of guitar, and I asked him, Devin plays these hollow bodies, but that's not a metal guitar. And he said, well, we make them a little bit, we fill them out a little bit more, and but we're looking at a hollow body with a Bixby and EMGs. Somewhere some luthier is turning around in his grave, right?
Well, I mean, it's a start. I mean, now I'm working with Fishman, and we've got a pickup that we're almost finished that has a switch that in one voice is a heavy metal pickup, and then the second voice is a low gain single coil pickup.
I was asking myself, sorry for not going at all where you were.
That's fine.
I was asking myself when I saw it on the wall, that Frames logo is totally dim. Like, why wouldn't they make that black and pop out? Because it freaking lights up.
Wow.
Yeah. Battery's a little dead on it.
I played right. this earlier, and I just did this.
You know, I've been working with so many guitar companies. I've had the opportunity to play with some brilliant guitarists, but Framus is perfect for me. We're doing, like I say, two guitars, and they're just, I've not worked with any company that is up that level.
I've played them years ago, and I told them this. I told Hans-Peter this. I played them years ago, and I said, feels good, feels firm, feels very German, feels very... They felt like a brick to me, a little bit, and I wasn't comfortable with them. And now I come here, years later, haven't played one since, pick up that Idol Maker over there. I played first the one with the single chords. That was, I was beyond my way. That was amazing. And then you pick up the Mahogany one, and I have very high VIN POS guitars at home. Sorry, Paul, sorry, Gavin, but... As thin and light as that guitar is, and as thick as that sound is, I would play that before I play my piano.
No, that is
the truth.
No, I am. Not only are these instruments what you just described, but they didn't pressure me in ways that not only I appreciated, but it's like any relationship. If you're in a band, if you're in a romantic relationship, it's the same thing. You have to have an understanding of how it works, and we're at a point with the industry where I have to pimp the stuff that I work with, and so it's taken me a long time to get to the point where I can work with a company where I can say to people, like, I mean, this is perfect for me.
Well,
so now that we're building certain...
Well, everyone here that we've talked to, and we realize it's not a spiel, it's not a thing that people say, we're living it right now, it's a family.
Oh, yeah.
And it's not just the instrument. Steve Bailey, Stu Hamm, Lee Scott, they could play anything they want. Phil X could play anything, he could play fucking Bon Jovi, okay? I mean, can you imagine this kind of Bon Jovi? That would be funny.
I grew in that band so quickly.
It would be really interesting.
I do not feel good about myself.
Bed of Roses, come on.
I don't know it.
Something with Bed of Roses is a good... Bon Jovi was my first love, actually.
Oh, yeah? Yeah.
My first album ever was the first Bon Jovi album.
Really?
Got it for my 15th birthday. With the list, 15th birthday.
Yeah.
Wow. But they could play anything. And it's A, the quality of the instrument needs to be there. And B, we just walk around here. I mean, we're doing walkthroughs and stuff. It's an amazing place, amazing people. You walk in the main office and there's cats and dogs running around.
Yeah.
And I think that's really what speaks to the endorsers.
It does, for sure. But that's the icing on the cake. I mean, for me, it's my needs for guitar after so much music and so many years have become distilled to a point where I have a really distinct vision of what it's going to take for me to accomplish what I need to do in the future. And it's not simple, and it's of a aesthetic level that it has to be a certain way, or I don't want to do it. I'll just play a bunch of stuff if that's the case. So finally coming here and taking the time with it and being able to go through the instrument, and today he's cut out blanks of the two instruments that we're working on for signature stuff. And it's, you know, I'm so fastidious and so OCD when it comes to everything in my world that I don't know if there'd be another company. There is no other company that would allow me nor be able to achieve what we're going
to
be able to do.
Well, they clearly are willing to say, okay, this is what you want. We're going to keep the minimum of what we need to keep on the instrument, so it's a Framus guitar, like maybe the headstock, but even on the Phil X, it's fucking huge. And he said, I want a big headstock. Well, then we do our headstock in big.
Yeah.
And you can see on the reversal bass, which is... But Adam, I mean, guy from U2, okay? He can play any instrument in the world. He wants a bass that's an Explorer reversed with a freaking crow's beak or something.
Don't
and he gets it.
Well, I think it's also compromise, any relationship as well. Like, I mean, if you go into a romantic relationship and refuse to compromise, it's not going to last. But I think it's the same with this. There's certain things, like the identity of a guitar company comes down to the headstock. So when I started working, I was like, well, I've got these ideas for a headstock and all this. And I said, well, we could do that. But in the long run, it'll not only serve the company, but also our relationship better if we can stick with something that we can get some brand identification off of, right? But I think that's where the family aspect of the company comes in really handy because, you know, one of my favorite quotes is always like, if you ever think you're enlightened, you just need to go spend a week with your family, right? And I think when you think about a family dynamic, it comes down to really being able to communicate. It's not a quick or easy thing, but when you have the willingness to learn about each other, the results in the long run are going to be much superior to
us. We hung out with Marcus a little bit and he showed us a couple of things and he knows his shit.
Yeah.
And he's definitely willing to listen and then learn and develop with the artist.
That's
which
it.
Is great.
That's it.
My goal is definitely to get some idol makers into my videos and in the studio and I'll play them proudly.
I love the idol maker. My only thing with the idol maker is I like thick, heavy guitars. So this one I liked because it was hollow and it was good for me. And the ones that I made with them subsequently are solid Mayfields that weigh 13 pounds. And for some reason, I feel that for what I do, there's an aspect of it that really benefits having that bulk.
Okay.
I love it. When we do the actual production runs of the guitar, because mine are going to be solid, we'll chamber them a bit to sort of bring that down to 8 or 9 pounds. But I think the... for me, it must be my personality. I got two Maxon or MXR pedals, and one of them was the
zinc, and the other one is the aluminum.
And their components are fundamentally identical, but because one was heavier, I thought it was of significantly higher quality.
Okay, the first thing we're going to do when we're done here, we go downstairs and you pick up the Jonas Hellborn bass.
Of course, I love it. That's actually too heavy for me. Yeah.
See, because we were like,
but that was actually, that's not the final version. That was a prototype that was too heavy for him.
Okay,
yeah,
good then.
Yeah.
On this one, I'm banging it, I guess. In the one now it's...
Let's go.
No, I gotta take it home.
If they can't, here's another thing.
I'll cheat now.
Here's
right?
Another, yeah, right. Here's another thing I'll add with the frame of stuff. Anything in my life that's fragile doesn't last. Like people, gear, you know, cables. If it breaks, I'm not meant to be in its company.
Okay.
So the frame of stuff, the
it's perfect then, because that's exactly the image I have. But the sound was always the same. It was too strict to me, but it's not anymore. Now I feel you can get subtlety out of it.
Of course.
The new guitars have these GraphTech ratio tuners.
Yes.
The new guitars have those too, because this has Grove on it.
Yeah, I've tried them. I prefer, this isn't the one that I would actually choose. My favorite one are the Grovers. Yeah, someone's ringing. My favorite one are the Grovers with the bigger heads and the lockers on the back. I mean, the ratio tuners are an interesting thing, but I don't need to experiment with tuners at this point.
Well, I kind of like the idea, but you have to get used to it. You have to get used to that, on E, all of a sudden you got to...
Well, you see, it seems like getting used to something that I don't need to get used to.
Okay,
right?
So your guitars would have...
They're these with the lockers on the back and the oversized.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I played this earlier and it's... Guys, listen to this. High-end. It's just... It's so bright.
Yeah.
While still having a lot of...
Like I say, I've got this set of pickups that I've been working with Fishman now. And we're doing a signature thing. And it's literally two voices. I went down... It's going to have a switch there.
Mm-hmm.
So in the down position, it's... the things about... an active pickup that I've come to expect, plus a different frequency range. So it's a heavy metal sound for me that's killer. But then, exactly. Then when you flip it to this, what we've got is it's
that's a good idea.
Thank you. The way that the pickups have been designed is that the second voice is a different pickup, essentially, and it's a single coil, really low output passive sound.
Okay.
So I can have it in a guitar like this, and be metal, and then flick it to there, and it's a single coil sound, and it's killer. Yeah. So with this, I mean, I use EMGs for years, and I love EMG, of course, but it's because the nature of what I do has typically been really bipolar, I need to have the two distinct sounds available on one instrument. And that was my first thought when we did this one. It was the first guitar I made with Framus, or I, you know, asked for more realistically. And the idea was to mix two things, you know, old school sort of 50s vibe, which I like, with a heavy metal sound. And the ones that we're going to end up doing with production are going to be that thought integrated into the entire design, right?
They're
beautiful. They're perfect.
I love it. I mean, I love the white idea. It's beautiful. And I've never been a fan of active pickups. I don't quite get the idea. And I always thought that I like lower output stuff. I don't like it when I plug into an amp and there's immediate distortion. The PRS guitars are a little bit like that, where I can't really get the clean sound.
Again, not to harp on this, just because I'm so into it, I went down to Boston and worked with Fishman. I worked with Larry. And he's a good dude, and he's brilliant. And the whole thing that we did is we put it into voice one with the same pickup. Marcus has got him in his office, you should see. And we voiced it, so it was the heavy metal sound I was looking for. But when you switch it, it is a low gain, passive. Even though it's an active pickup, it's voiced because of the technology, the Fluence stuff, to be a replica of a passive, low output pick. And it's, for a situation like this, it's just so great because you can flick it to that and just noodle away on a low output, like the things that you require out of your pickups. But then when it's time to, rock, you can
do that. Which
is
talking about that on the Pantera models, which I thought was a killer option, and it's no matter where you are, in between position, whatever, and you have maybe the volume rolled back a little bit, and maybe you have the tone rolled back a little bit. You have this extra switch up here, which if you hit it, it immediately goes in the bridge directly out the cable.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Because that might be something you want.
I
played with that and it's killer. You can have anything set up on the guitar you want. And if you then need to go to right out power cord, full blast, flip the switch, you can go back to your dialed-in sound that you heard earlier.
Cool. Oh, that's cool. I mean, it's more options than I would require, but I do think that's a really good idea. When we were putting together the signature one, I have, like I mentioned earlier, a really set collection of parameters that I require to do what I do, and those pickups allow me to do two things on one guitar for live, plus the model that I have been using now has got the Evertune bridge on it, which I can't express how much that piece of gear has inspired me. I am so OCD, as I mentioned before, with all aspects of my life, and tuning makes me fucking crazy. I'm in open C, and if it does that, the temperature has modified the pitch of the neck and the truss rod and all that. We played Summer Breeze last year, the year before. We played at midnight, it was raining, we had just gotten off of a plane. But because of the way the Evertune works, it's a bridge system that has springs on the inside with a routing much like a Floyd Rose routing would be, that when you set your intonation and your tuning, no matter what you do to the strings, to the neck, to the stretching, it will compensate for that. So you are always in tune. As a result of that, we went on stage and I was perfectly in tune without touching the tuning. I've got my guitar at home. I've got a Mayfield, a solid one with the Evertune. I haven't tuned it in 6 months, and it's, not 6 months, 2 months, but it's perfectly in tune. So every time I grab the guitar, I never have to stress about, oh shit, my G's out, or I stretch that.
I read about the system. It has to be set up for the string gauges, obviously.
Yeah, but you can do that yourself.
Really?
Yep. And a lot of people had expressed concerns about the fact that, well, you can't bend on it. Well, there's two modes that you can use it in. You can have it, basically you have it set so you tune up normal, you put the string in like normal, tune it up, and then all of a sudden you'll notice the pitch stops changing mm-hmm. for about 12 revolutions of the tuning peg. In that zone two, with an Allen key, you tune it.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you're in the middle of that, maybe 6 revolutions in, if you bend, the pitch doesn't change.
Okay.
So you can have it, for example, if you're tracking somebody who has bad intonation, even if their fingers are doing crazy things, the pitch will be correct.
Really?
Then as you go towards the third zone, maybe at 11 revolutions or 12, you go to 13, you hear the pitch go up all of a sudden.
Okay.
Bring it back a turn and a half, and at that point you can bend like a normal guitar. And for me,
I gotta look into that system a bit more.
Yeah, and I mean, it's some people, I think it's like training wheels or something like this, but for me, as a professional...
No, the stupid robo-tune, that's training
that's
wheels.
That's stupid, I hate okay. that shit. But I mean, it's like, for me as a singer and a performer and somebody who's so OCD about it, and a studio recorder where if I have a flash of inspiration, I can lose my zeal to record simply because my guitar is out of tune. I've got a guitar in the studio that I can rely on being in tune. I can go on stage after flying. My guitar is in tune. Mm-hmm. It's like, so the final version of the Frameless that we're going to make is going to be a really distinct vision of what I've come to expect from a guitar. It obviously won't be for everybody, but for me, it's exactly what I need.
And for, you know, every Devin Townsend nutso out there, there must be a few.
Yeah, well, there's a few. I think it's like, they morph though, you know, there's been some folks that have been kind enough to stick around for 25 years of what I'm doing, but we all grow together. And one thing that I find really satisfying about my own career is the fact that there's people still that support what I do without necessarily liking it anymore. But at least they know that because I'm doing it for the reasons that I'm doing it, that it's worth supporting. It's like,
I would consider myself, except for one word, one of these people that's been there from the very beginning. I would say not liking it, but it said it's, I wouldn't want to listen to 3 wall of sound albums in a row because it is a little bit tiring.
Of course.
And I've poked my head in once in a while. I was there from Sex and Religion, and I remember Berkeley, Boston, some chick dragged me off the street because we talked about something, and she dragged me in her car and I was getting afraid. It was an old beat up car, because we talked about heavy music.
Sounds kinky.
I was hoping, but nothing happened. And she puts in this, I think it was a tape back then. You guys have now. She's like, no, you want to hear heavy shit here? And she plays me Strapping on That. And I didn't know that you were involved with that, and I was like, okay, that is heavy. Thank you very much. And then he said I bought Terrier and I think one other album, can't remember what that was. And now I got to come. So I always poke my head in and see what's going on.
Thank you.
When people ask me, I'm gonna let you go, we wanna go grab coffee, we've been here forever, and thank you for
You're
this.
Welcome.
When people ask me, so who's that Devin Townsend guy? He's vocalist, he's a brilliant pop rock vocalist, brilliant songwriter. His vocalist from his band. Rafael Cano, Spanish guy.
Mm.
Arms like this, legs like this.
Really?
Creepy.
How big is his torso? Normal?
He's creepy.
Oh, okay.
You remember him once you've seen him.
Really?
And he can sing. Seriously.
Yeah.
Sorry, Rafa. That's the truth. We don't lie to you. This is the internet. It's only facts.
Is that thalidomide? Is that the... Oh.
Anyway, where was it going? I showed him some stuff, and even though it was heavy or whatever, and he was like, okay, I gotta check out more. This is it's awesome. But I always try to find words to describe your music. And one of them is obviously wall of sound. The other thing I say is imagine Enya in heavy.
Mm.
You heard that before? Has
of course, yeah, that was my intention.
Okay.
When I was a kid, yeah, I loved Watermark so much. That mixed with Metallica and Def Leppard was perfect. But I think
and then smash that together.
Yeah, but I think it's, I mean, I would be suspicious of someone who listens to their own music a lot. You know, I do music because I feel compelled to do it, and when it's done, I don't want to hear it again. I mean, I'm finished.
Right here with you.
So I think that if I was to summarize my music in any way, I wouldn't be able to find any words either, because it's not something I would choose to listen to. I like Casualties of Cool. I think that's a good record. I like some parts of Ghost. I think that's good. I like a lot of what I've done, but for reasons that are sometimes, as you had suggested with your own music, separate from the content. That being said, it provides me fuel to want to achieve the feeling that I know I think I'm capable of achieving. And maybe the symphony is it. Maybe it isn't. Maybe it's just an acoustic thing. Who knows? Maybe it's nothing. Maybe it is bass. Maybe it's nothing.
But this is what being a musician is like: continuing the journey, looking for new things.
Yeah.
But to try to illustrate what you just said, on the first Frameshift album, it was all about Richard Dawkins and evolution. Every album, every song was a chapter out of a Richard Dawkins zoology.
Is he the
God's Delusion, he wrote that.
Oh yeah.
He's a zoologist.
I think he's clever, but he seems like such an asshole.
I think he just seems to be that.
Okay.
He's extremely clever.
Yeah.
And his books are on evolution. I've read all of them.
My friends tell me I should read it, but I just saw an interview with him when he was interviewing Deepak Chopra, who I have no emotional connection to, but he was so rude about his approach that I haven't given him a chance since.
The thing is, he gets a lot of shit from the religious side, and I think he just fights back with the same kind of shit.
Do you think that's wise for a man as clever as him? Do you think it helps his cause? Because
I call myself a radical atheist. Hmm. Because
I'm a confused agnostic.
I think because we're always polite, and you have to respect religion, you have to respect faith, and I don't understand why. If I think something's stupid, I'm going to say so. I'm sorry, you step into shit with that.
Doesn't that imply, though, that you think you're right?
Absolutely.
So you do think you're right? You think you know unequivocally what you know?
That there is no higher being, yes.
When you define higher being?
Someone who made us.
Like a person?
Or anything.
And so you know that unequivocally?
I know it. Yes.
Okay.
And I don't have a major respect for, you know, some cultural thing that happened because it was smart at some point and then got dragged thousands of years later.
Of course not.
It still doesn't make sense.
No, of course.
And now makes serious problems in society because of rules that don't apply anymore. And people also, you have to respect that. And I think
I respect that for sure. I mean, I think that fundamentalism in any way is dangerous. And I think that religion is something that my only concern, and this is coming from somebody that doesn't know shit, and I know less now than I did this morning, right? But my only concern is all these experiences are rooted in something that, you know, some scientific communities might think are just chemical reactions inside, you know, a sentient chunk of meat or whatever we are. But there's also an aspect of religion that it becomes a metaphor and analogy on something that's so, like, anybody who's had a spiritual significance, whether or not it's chemical, whether or not it's acid or death or birth or trauma or something, it seems to be rooted in something similar. And I guess, you know, faith for me, if I was to define it strictly as the term of being, I don't know, believing in something that there's you can never have any proof for.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's an aspect of that that I find solace in mathematics or the infinite or the idea of the universe being something that is external from me. But at the same time, when you think back to, well, maybe it's all a delusion, maybe it's all a hologram, maybe it's, you know, the infinite realities and basically we are the architects of our own destiny and everything that goes into it, I just find that I just don't think I'm fucking smart enough to know anything.
I fully agree with that.
Yeah.
And that's what I like about science, because I say, okay, we look at this, we have proof for this, all the other stuff, we don't know. We have so much not unknowledge.
Well, okay,
And science goes into that, and we don't try to fill it with some,
yeah,
some story.
I agree with that. I agree with that. The only thing is, with science as well, if you think about things on, you know, like even if you think of quantum bullshit. I don't know anything about it, but from what
I've never
know,
can be proven, apparently.
Well, this is what I'm wondering about science in general. If everything exists simultaneously, then everything's bullshit. And I like that.
That everything is bullshit.
Yeah, because it makes things like humor and music and love and, you know, all that sort of stuff that veers into the grossness of humanism and all that stuff seem significant all of a sudden. I mean, what was it, Descartes? I saw a thing on one of his theories the other day of, do you fundamentally exist? And the idea of, well, you think, therefore you do exist, being the end of that. I thought that was really interesting, because if you don't think you exist, then maybe you don't. But if you're able to tangibly take something out of life, whatever it is, whatever, food, sex, then on some level it provides some sort of evidence. But the problem with that is you think, well, maybe you're just afraid of dying. If you need evidence to live, then maybe really you're just fucked. Because it's just like, unless I control this, I cease to exist. And the thought of that is terrifying. It's like, that's what deconstruction, that was that record. It's like the guy was so convinced that he knew that he was presented it after extensive analysis, and then what he was presented was something stupid. In that case, it was a cheeseburger. And so when all of a sudden presented, he's just like, all I've been looking at is, you know, an aspect of infinity. And if infinity is even real, as opposed to just a construct of a limited entity like humankind, then no matter how far you go in any direction, intellectually, creatively, anyway, you never move. It's an illusion. If that's the case, then you don't exist. But I love the idea that it's all just this sort of psychobabble bullshit. And so my point is, Richard Dawkins seemed really rude to Deepak Chopra in that thing. And I don't. Both of them seem like bananas to me.
Yeah, you know? The thing is, he gets that way because he gets a lot of shit, and
so that's his defense.
And he's just fed up with it. And he said, I fight back. I do agree. But where I was going is, back to the music, after the infinity thing, is on this album, there's a song called La Mer, which is...
Which album?
On that Frameshift album where I wrote about evolutionary theories. And it's about that these shells that they find on the beach, they're all different. They all follow the golden ratio and all this, but they're all different, and they move in a 3D space of possible shell mutations. But you can't write a song about that. So I wrote a song about someone finding the shell, and it's beginning his journey into thinking about evolution. Puts it on his nightstand, and it always stays a reminder of the thing that started his life journey in watching things outside and learning about evolution. So the wife of the labor boss calls me and says, oh, this is so amazing, I love that song, because it means something to me, you know, and it had a certain meaning for me. But she calls me and says, I love it because it's about Jesus. And it couldn't be further away from what I was trying to say.
I guess that goes back to what I was almost trying to say a second ago, though, how religion, as flawed as it may be, in some sense, may be rooted to very similar things that are ultimately resonating with people on some fundamental level. Sometimes I think people need an analogy or a metaphor, and I think a lot of the reason why those ancient texts end up having stories is ways to illustrate things that are beyond language.
As long as they're seen as stories and metaphors. But
yeah,
that's,
of course.
It doesn't stay
of
there.
Of course, no, I agree with that.
But what you said about, we might have a certain feeling doing an album, which for us it's done and thank you, but it means something else to someone else. And
is that okay with you?
In this case, I actually tried to explain to her, sadly, that I didn't mean that, but I should have just shut up. I should have just said, you know what, if it gives you something, then that's good.
I agree with that.
And I did the wrong thing. I tried to tell her that, no, it's not about that, it's about the opposite. And
that's cool that you feel the need to recognize that, whether or not it's right or wrong, that I think is really cool.
No, my music gave her something. Mm. And I was kind of trying to take that away at that moment, which was very wrong.
I've done the same, of course.
I ask you one more question.
Sure.
Which has been plaguing me, well, I've been thinking about it for 25 years.
Do you have to pee? Yes.
Then really fast, really fast. No,
I can't be if people know I'm being.
Steve Vaughn, I saw you guys in Frankfurt, Neu-Isenburg. And he came on stage like I imagined him, like this.
God.
Mm-hmm. With the wind and the hair and the long leather coat and everything. And fully, what's it called, you know?
Flamboyant.
Yes. And you came out in sweatpants and nothing else.
I don't do that anymore, for what it's worth.
But it was kind of like this devilish creature. Excuse my French there, okay? Mm-hmm. And then there was that a staged kind of, was it planned, or was it just how you guys were at the time?
Well, I think I was very antagonistic towards Steve at that point, because when I was younger, his music and his image was very important to me, and when I met him and realized that he's a person, mm-hmm. it was like the deflowering of my idealism when I was 19. And I think that my reaction to him past that point was based in just being a petulant kid. So anytime he would ask me to do something, I would inevitably do the opposite. And in the beginning of the cycle, I think he had a vision for what he wanted me to present myself as that was in line with his vision for the album. But I just didn't, because I was a shit. And
I thought it was brilliant.
It wasn't, again, intentional. It was just I was probably trying to be.
It will never get out of my head, this opposition on stage. Yeah. But we're done. That's it. You need to pee. But after you pee, don't run away. I need to talk to you about more.
Well, talk to me now.
You sure?
Yeah,
you
sure. No, I'm good.
Have you seen the bathroom outside? It's the most beautiful bathroom.
I can't
bathroom
pee if I gotta come back.
Okay, well then turn off the cameras. We're gone. This was Devin Townsend. We've been here forever, and this was the most amazing interview ever. For me.
Thank you, brother.
For you guys, I know.
Appreciate it, man.
Thank you.
You're welcome.